Friends, my name is Ankur Pandey. I work for 24/7 Innovation Labs. So today I'll be talking about some of the aspects, some of the critical aspects behind predictive analytics. Actually, I'll be focusing on the text mining side of the sports scenario. So now, what is predictive analytics? As most of you are familiar, probably that we basically want to leverage some insights, some inference out of the data we have, and we want to make a prediction, right? Now, in many of these circumstances, the data we deal with is essentially text data, which is unstructured. I mean, we have the log data and other kind of more structured data as well, but I'll focus more on the unstructured part of the data. So, text data is, inherently, it's very high dimensional and sparse. Now, what do I mean by this? So high dimension because in a particular corpus we have not many words, and in a particular dictionary there are a lot of words, and each document would only have so many words out of the dictionary, right? So in that sense, if we treat each word as a dimension, each document would comprise a lot of dimensions. And vice versa, because only few of these dimensions will eventually be filled, right? So this is what I mean when I say it's a high dimensional sparse. Now, we'll look at how do we capture the text data, how do we represent the text data. So initially, first of all, I like to point out that the general step done to whenever we start dealing with text data is some kind of pre-processing. So in the pre-processing phase, we typically remove the stock words, which is nothing but the very commonly occurring words, like articles we have, right, and the positions and all those sorts of things. So this is called stock word removal, and there is something called stemming, which means that we basically cut down the word to its root. So for example, raining becomes rain and so on. So this is the standard pre-processing step we do in most cases, not all cases, but in most cases. Now, text data can be represented in a variety of ways. One of them is bag of words. Now, when I say bag of words, I mean that we don't really take into account the relative positioning of the words in a particular document. Right. So that's why it's bag of word. So out of which a particularly famous model is vector space model. Now, vector space model, as I had initiated in the last slide itself, is basically representing your document in a vector, and which has the dimensions of the entire the vocabulary you have, the entire dictionary you have. I'll show you a visual presentation the next. So this matrix is called term document matrix. So you're seeing that each row represents a particular document. And we have n documents in this particular corpus, which is nothing but a collection of documents. So each word, each document has, here in this case, p words, right? So this W11, W21, and so on, these are the words which denotes the elements of this particular matrix. I'll just move on to the previous slide once again. So I have written that the measure of these elements. So how do we? What is the value we give to these elements? So value can be given in a variety of ways, out of which the popular ways are simply count how many times this particular word is occurring in a document, which is nothing but the term frequency. But a slightly better way to capture the the distinctive information of your document is to use something called TF-IDF. Now what is TF-IDF? TF-IDF is term frequency multiplied by inverse document frequency. So for example, if you have a word which is occurring a lot of times in a particular document, it will have a high term frequency, right? So suppose take an article like THED. But this article also occurs in a lot of other documents. So document frequency, which is the number of documents this particular word is occurring, is also high, which means that IDF is low, right? So TF multiplied by IDF will be low. So essentially the idea, this TF-IDF measure captures the distinctiveness of a particular word in a document. So the most commonly occurring word throughout the corpus will have a low TF-IDF, And you know, the birds which are going to vary infrequently will also have a low TF-IDF. So the the birds which will have high TF-IDF are typically the birds which occur in one or only few documents a lot of times, but occur very few times in other documents. So this, as you can intuitively guess, captures a lot of information about a particular document in a given corpus. Now, having said that, in this very slide, assume that the mews are TF-IDFs now. So each document can be represented by, as you can see in the right side, by a vector, right? So now, how do we measure the similarity between the two documents? So a simple way of measuring the similarity, there can be other ways, but one straightforward way is to measure a cosine, this cosine, the theta, cos theta of this particular between the documents. So if the documents are very much similar, they will have the cosine value. They will basically, the vector will be as near to each other. So so this is very intuitively a feeling as well. There are, as I pointed out, other measures also. Right. So as I had already talked about, that this particular bag of word model doesn't capture the positioning of words, right? So for example, if I have a sentence, say this sentence is a word document, as an example, I can give you that it is raining, and the other sentence is raining is it. So these two documents will be in the bag of words model, they will not be differentiated, because the related positions are not being measured here. So this we can measure by something called n-gram model, right? Actually the example I gave you was not that great, because n-gram model will also capture the same thing, because n-gram I mean that instead of capturing now one word, will capture a particular group of words, like a sequence of n words or something like that. So this is just an example I had given you to demonstrate that there are other ways to capture to represent our text data. Now, the more interesting parts of this representation are the semantic models, because they are able to somehow capture the information, the semantic information which a text gives. They are not like as blind as the previous models. So one of them could be parsing. Now in parsing, parsing typically means, as most of you would be familiar, it means that tagging the sentences in our given document into subjects, objects and verbs and so on, right? So if with our text data, we have this additional information about what the nature of those particular words, we'll have some more semantic information about the word. But but other computational techniques also exist to basically capture this semantic information. So these could be, one of them could be dimensionality reduction. So as the name suggests, the dimensionality reduction means that out of this huge dimension which a document has, as I pointed out, that a document has will have all the dimensions of the words occurring in a dictionary, right? So we don't want that, because in a typical document we don't have all the words from a particular dictionary, right? So we would want to reduce that. So one way is to capture this is a technique called latent semantic analysis, or indexing it's called sometimes in a different context. So next slide tells something about it. So see, the idea is to see, X here is again a term document matrix. So without going too much into mathematical detail, I'll just tell you the machinery, what does this machinery does, right? So what happens is that once you have the representation in this matrix form, the text document matrix I had pointed out previously, right, this one. So so this particular matrix could be used, could be expressed as as a product of U, sigma and V, where V are transpose. So where, forget about what do the mean, but here the important point is to remember that sigma here is a diagonal matrix, right? So this is called a singular value decomposition. And sigma, the important takeaway from this is that sigma here now is a diagonal matrix, which means that it only has values in the diagonal part, right? Now what we do to reduce the dimension is to truncate the sigma. So suppose you have the sigma is like an n cross n matrix. So you just truncate, say for example, you just choose the first k, the values in this very diagonal, right? And form another diagonal matrix, and by some operation, just revert back to original x. So essentially what I'm saying is that from x, as you can see in the, you know, this the lower line, x we have decomposed into u, v, and s. And from s, we made something like asterisk s, which is again a, you know, truncated form of s, and we recovered this thing, asterisk x. So now this asterisk x will have a lower dimension than this original x, and will somehow magically will be a, you know, representation of the same matrix in a dimensionally reduced form. So this is the essential mathematical machinery behind this LSA. So there are other dimensionality reduction techniques as well, but this was just an illustrative example. Then there are different class of methods called topic models. Now what are these topic models? So topic models, specifically I will tell you something about LDA, which means latent Dirichlet allocation. So again, the name might sound scary, but the essential idea behind LDA is this. What we do, the standard assumptions we take is that assume that the number of words in the documents in a corpus, so in corpus as in the collection of documents, the number of words in the document are distributed as per some distribution. Forget about word distribution now. So assume that they follow some probabilistic distribution as of now. Now you assume that, you know, each document is again a distribution of some topics. So the idea behind LDA is to figure out what topics these are. I mean, till this point, we don't really know what are the topics we're going to talk about. We just assume that this is like, which is a very intuitive guess, right? I mean, whatever you're talking about, each document of you will be a mixture or something of that sort of some particular topics. Say your document is talking about, some sports sometime, but then it's talking about politics some other time, right? So you can say that it's 90% sports and 10%, what politics, and so on. So this is a very intuitive assumption. And then, last assumption is that, each topics is a distribution over words. So what this LDA does is to, backtrack from this assumption. So these might look like innocuous, assumptions, but they basically give you very, they decompose your documents into certain topics. So basically you will get the topics which are describing your whole document. So far we have seen in semantic models, parsing, dimensionality reduction, and topic models. Again, there are other kinds of topic models as well. So these techniques, as you must have seen that, what can we basically leverage out of these topic models? So one, state called application is to basically, kind of club together. For example, if we have two different documents and both are talking a lot about sports, right? So we can kind of merge them together. Merge in the sense we can group them together. So we can say, okay, these topics, these particular documents are talking a lot of sports. So let's form a group of these. And there are other topics which are talking, other documents which are talking a lot about politics, say, other talking about food. So there is an essential grouping involved in this topic model. So this grouping is technically called as clustering. So there are other clustering approaches also. So the idea was to say, demonstrate that this topic modeling in itself is a clustering approach. So as you might be familiar, clustering is nothing but grouping of this documents in certain understandable groups. I'll just demonstrate an example of a clustering method, a popular method called k-means clustering. So in k-means clustering, see if you can look at the diagram given below, the illustrative diagram. So what happens is that we in this data points we have somehow represented our document by this very points. Just select randomly. Suppose I want to group this entire collection of documents into three groups, right? So what I did, as a standard procedure, what I can do is to select any three. I mean, this can vary actually, but one of the approaches that we select any three random points, which are represented here by red, green, and blue, right? Now what we do is that we see, okay, what are the points nearest to these points? So if you can, one nearness measure could be this, the cosine similarity, but there could be other nearness measures also. So for the sake of, explanation, can assume that, the documents which are nearer to this are clubbed together. So if you can see in the second of the figure, so the red, we have colored several documents, which is to indicate that these particular documents are clubbed together. Now what we do is that we again, figure out the centroid of this particular group. So for now, in this picture, we have three different groups. But these may not be the, very group we want, because I mean, this may not be the final answer here. So what we do is that we again figure out the centroids of these particular groups. So you can see that in the third picture, how are we figuring out the centroid? And after figuring out the centroid, we have three new points, and again repeat the same procedure. The procedure converges after a point, and we have a stable clustering. So this is as you can see that in the last picture, we have a natural clustering which has emerged out of this too many documents we have written with you. Again a problem comes, usual problem we are faced with, which is called classification. So the difference between clustering and classification is that in clustering we don't really know what are the groups we are going to our data is going to fall in. So it's in that sense unsupervised. In classification we know, we know the groups we want. We know that, for example, our data deals with, say, food, sports, and politics. And we want to beforehand we know everything about the data, the groups at least. So, and we want to figure out that which document in our corpus belongs to which group, in the nearest possible sense. So, so this is the classification, definition of the classification problem. And, so classification problem can also be approached in a variety of ways. Two distinctive ways could be rule-based and other, let me talk about rule-based classifier first. So the rule-based classifier is, for example, if you're dealing with text data, you can figure out, suppose your text data deals with a lot of, customer data. So so you can say, the particular documents or the particular, this paragraphs which talk a lot about, say, buying or selling, I'll say, these documents talk a lot about buying something. The document which talks about customer help or something like that talks about let us group into the help required category. I'm just giving an example. So we can have a lot of rules. We can have if this word is present or this particular phrase is present, let's do this and so on. So this is basically a rule based machinery. So so an example of this could be a decision tree approach. So see this example. So here this decision tree is finding that how many the survival of the passengers in the Titanic ship, right? So for example, the information we have is based on the observation we have collected, right? So essentially it's like the data, we ask questions to data. We employ rules to the data and we ask questions. So here we are asking, is the sex male? Yes. If yes, then is the average age greater than 9.5 years? Then there is a probability that this much the probability that he has died, and this much the probability. CBSP means that if he has siblings or if he has the the wives or something. So this then so much the probability. So this gives us the so this is based on our past data. So this is just an illustrative example that how do we so for example, if you have a if you are dealing with some some website which has a lot of traffic from everywhere. So you can one strategy could be to employ such a decision tree learning framework and figure out a lot of things in your previous data and then try in the new data which you have presented, try to see where does it fit into. So this is the essential model for the decision tree learning approach. Then we have other class of approach called linear classifier. So you might be familiar with something called logistic regression. So what linear classifier do is that it basically the output can be framed as a linear algebraic combination of our document and a coefficient vector. Okay, so let me not talk a lot about this. I'll show you two example cases where it is used in industry. So this model is called query categorization. So if we can look into this data. So this is typically the customer data we have, right? So you can see the labels agents and customer, right? So we have figured out that these are the lines say regarding greetings. We have the lines regarding issues and so on, right? So these are the standard classification approaches we have used. So now having figured out that which one of the line leads to the greeting, which is the issue line, which is the resolution line, and so on, we have a second level of categorization among these very lines. So for example, among these very cancellation lines, the lines typed by customer, which says something about cancellation of a particular product, we again categorize into a second level of classification, which could be visible here in the down left. So you know, I mean, so this is the standard approach we do, and on a day-to-day basis in our data. And this multi-level classification gives you a lot of insight about you know, what do you do with the, I mean, first of all, it tells you the numerical measures of how many customers are like rejecting or accepting and so on. So you see that where the power of this segregation lies. Now, so this is a good example, but this is not particularly a very sophisticated example. A sophisticated example of this whole machinery could be something called ontology learning. Now, what is an ontology? So an ontology basically is a, you know, is a kind of, you can say a sort of dictionary, or rather a thesaurus, actually, and more than that, which captures a lot of information about the terms you have in your data, the kind of groupings which these terms have, the kind of relatedness which one concept has to another concept, and so on, and what are the rules you can you know, figure out from your data, right? For example, you can figure out an example of the rule could be that, okay, suppose you know, the customer is saying no in one of the lines, in any three lines consecutively, so he's not going to buy at all, or he's not going to kind of convert into a, you know, into a prospective customer at all. So these kind of rules, axiomatic rules, could be figured out from your existing data. So you can see that these kind of, you know, I mean, this is again a very high level picture, but then these kind of rules employ a lot of machinery. I mean, if you can figure out to extract the terms, like which are the important terms on the data, we require a lot of pre-processing, then we require a lot of, you know, as in we have to extract terms, as in we have to pass terms that they are nouns and so on. And then again, so to form the concept out of these texts, we have standard clustering approaches. Then once you have found the concept, you want to kind of level the concept into hierarchies. So we can do something called hierarchical clustering, which is not a plain clustering, which I mean that it's not just grouping the data into regular clusters, but it is into, you know, kind of a cluster of the, you know, increasing or decreasing order. So there could, you would have a one big cluster which will have everything, then you have sub-cluster and so on, right? So by this very fashion, you can basically, you know, club all your concepts into a kind of tree network. Then you figure out the relations. So one of the, you know, kind of software straightforward way to figure out the relations in your data is to see, you know, that, okay, that, I mean, use something called that by, if you can extract the words, like, you know, the relational words like by and some prepositions, that I have this. So you can extract have and see what are the, you know, subjects and objects leading to it. So these could be one of the straightforward ways, and there are other sophisticated ways as well. So this was just to give you, you know, and a taste of what goes on in this machinery. Alright, so these are the few good references I have brought down. So if you are any more interested, you can learn from these books. So, thanks. Do you have any questions? Yeah.
You spoke about the clustering technique in the cosine similarity for text data. So, is it only applicable to text kind of data, or you can select to a video format or something?
No, you can see, I mean, as long as you can represent your data vectorially, you can obviously employ it, this cosine similarity in any data. And again, this is not the only similarity measure there. This is one of the, I mean, again, this was because it was an introductory talk, so I could only talk about the kind of things we have on a daily basis.
Because when we talk about duplication suppression of text data, we achieve a higher throughput than any other kind of data.
Fine.
When we talk about duplication or compression of text kind of data, the throughput achieved is much higher than video format kind of data. So, I'm just wondering if this technique can be applicable to the other.
Okay, so that's the efficiency part, I'm not very aware, but at least, you know, as far as the theory is concerned, you know. You know, technically you can always employ this kind of methodology in any data which can be represented vectorially, right? So, yeah, I mean, you might be right about what are the, you know, if the clustering method is more efficient by this very measure, that can be understood. Thank you very much.